Hello everybody, we're back with Jason, but you're asking questions to Paula Vennells. Go by the timestamp if you don't want to listen to this, but what really bugs me about being a bloke is that if I go to anywhere formal, I've got to wear a suit with a tie, shiny shoes, heavy suits with a tie, really uncomfortable and sweating away. Yet women, you can wear anything you like in what any colour you like. Even to this inquiry, we've seen snakes on a chain. That looks as if she got it from the bargain bin at Shein. And now we've got Paula Vennells wearing some sort of C-list knockoff version of Star Trek. I think that everyone should be forced to go to anywhere formal wearing black and white only. I am not suggesting that Mr. Beer and Mr. Blake should rock up wearing a frock. I am just saying it should be black and white only. And if you want a little bit of colour, a nice tie, a brooch, a little scarf maybe, but not dressed in whatever you feel like it. It's just so rude.
Miss Ellis, can we return to where we were, which was what you told a group of parliamentarians on the 18th of June 2012 about postmasters and mistresses having been tempted to put their hands in the till and treat it like a lending facility, as some retail businesses did, that the post office had never lost a case. And that whenever Horizon had been investigated, it was found not to have been at fault. We established that none of those three things were in the briefing prepared specifically for the purposes of this meeting. And I think you said that you drew these things from other sources, is that right?
Yes.
One of them, I think you said that you drew from a board meeting in January of that year, January 2012. We can see that you're present, as is, amongst other people, Susan Crichton.
Yes.
A significant litigation report. It is recorded that Susan Crichton explained that the sub-postmasters were challenging the integrity of the Horizon system. However, the system had been audited by Royal Mail Group internal audit, with the reports reviewed by Deloitte. The audit report was very positive. I'm not going to examine at the moment whether any of that's true. But then this, the business had also won every criminal prosecution in which it had used evidence based on the Horizon system's integrity. Is that the occasion that you're referring to?
It is, as I said earlier, and that view was understood in the post office generally.
What do you mean that view was understood in the post office generally?
That Susan had... Well, my recollection was that, from seeing the documentation, it wasn't a memory, that Susan had said that in that board meeting. And I don't think it was a surprise when she said it, because it was an assumption, it was an understanding in the organisation that this was the case.
That post office had 100% hit rate.
I don't think it was mentioned in that way, but yes, in terms of the way that it's described here. And clearly that was completely inaccurate in many different ways, as you drew attention before the break.
But when she was asked about this paragraph, Susan Crichton said that she had relied on what Jarmel Singh had told her.
Yes, I heard her say that.
From your perspective, however, you would say that you're entitled to rely on what... the general counsel said in the formal surroundings of a board meeting.
Absolutely.
Were you aware of any system in place for cases which did not result in a conviction, or in civil cases did not result in the sub-postmaster being found liable, to be reported back to the board or a subcommittee of the board?
No.
That there was a system in place for a report to be written, I suspect in the business it would have been called a lessons learned report, which it found out what had gone wrong.
Are you telling me there was, or are you asking me if I... Right.
Some people have told us that there was, that in every case that we didn't succeed in, counsel was asked to write a report about what went wrong. We found none of them.
No, that never came to board level or to group executive level.
And was there a system in place that you're aware of where that would have happened if the post office had lost any of its cases?
I don't believe there was, and there should have been.
Do you know how it is that You were being given false information at the board's meeting, and you, on your account, deployed that 6 months later to parliamentarians.
I'm sorry, could you repeat the question?
Yes, how did it come about, in your view, that false information was perpetuated, regurgitated, deployed in this way?
It's important to state, first of all, that I didn't believe it was false information, and I don't suppose any board colleague did either. If you're given information, and this is another governance lesson, but if you're given information by the highest lawyer in the organisation, you take it completely as the truth, because you assume that lawyers, and I must be clear, I'm not implying anything here at all in terms of Susan Crichton, but one assumes that lawyers work to a professional code, and one, and the post office didn't, I think, with hindsight, have sufficient oversight to check whether that was or wasn't the case. So if that statement was made at a board meeting, if any statement was made at a board meeting, the board would take it as fact and truth.
And when you got to the meeting of the 18th of June, you were essentially deploying your memory, were you, of what had been said at this board meeting 6 months earlier?
I'm sure that was the case.
And what about the postmasters have been led into temptation?
That's a more difficult one to talk about. The first thing I would say on that is to apologise, because I'm very aware that that was not the case, and it was an assumption that I made based on two things. Examples of cases where I was told, and the inquiry has seen this in documentation, that in theory at least that took place. But my second evidence base for that was during the rollout of the Horizon Online pilot. Every branch had to be audited in terms of its cash position. And we were dealing with 11,000 post offices. The audit process would not normally be announced, because to do audits, the premise was that you went to audit a branch at a particular moment in time and you found it as it was. As we went into the Horizon Online rollout, I was in a meeting with George Thompson from the NFSP, and assumed we would be doing audits in the same way, which is that auditors would turn up to the branches, do an audit unannounced as they normally were. He suggested that that would be a very foolish thing to do, because there may be any number of branches where the cash might be short. George explained that it wasn't a frequent practice, but infrequently, a postmaster may need to nip down to the wholesaler and may borrow cash from the post office account and put it back the next day. There was no suggestion by George that that was done in terms of theft or fraud or anything like that, but that there was an understanding, he led me to believe, that that was a possibility. And so what the post office should do would be to let, and I thought it was sensible, I was shocked when he explained why, but I thought it was sensible that we should at least let people know that auditors were going. So I had that also as an evidence base, that there was, perhaps temptation is too strong a word in some of the cases he was describing, but there might occasionally be circumstances where postmasters had borrowed cash with the very honest intention of putting it back, and it might not have been there.
And is there a written record of what you just said?
I don't believe so, but it was in a meeting with George Thompson and Kevin Gilliland at the time.
Can we turn to a related topic of this theme of whether your intention was to protect, whether your priority was to protect the business? You were involved in correspondence and decision-making following the death of Martin Griffiths, weren't you?
Yes, I was.
By way of background, Mr. Griffiths, is this right, had worked for the post office in Ellesmere Port in Cheshire for about 20 years, and he was accused of taking, misappropriating, losing some £61,000 after the Horizon system had shown a shortfall. You remember?
I understand that's right.
And separately, some £50,000 was stolen from his post office in the course of an armed robbery. Yes?
Yes, I should say that I wasn't aware of that at the time, but there was an email which details some of that that I was copied into.
And he was alleged by the post office to be responsible for that loss sustained in the course of the armed robbery,
yeah,
and was required to repay some of it to the post office.
I understand that he shouldn't have been.
And shortly afterwards, he took his own life. Can we look, please, at poll 00301440? And look at the last page, please. If we just scroll to the foot of the page. In fact, it's not signed off. If we scroll up a little bit, please. And a little bit more. And a bit more. We can see the beginning of this chain from Alan Bates at 4:02 on Monday, the 23rd of September. And it's to you and others.
Yes.
And Mr. Bates says, this afternoon I received the following email. It's a prime example of the thuggery being exerted on defenceless sub-postmasters as the post office deny legal representation by arrogant and uncontrolled post office personnel. Despite assurances from on high that this type of thing is in the past, it's clear from post office's actions it's still alive and active through the ranks. And then there's the email. Hello, Alan. I'm writing on behalf of my son-in-law, Martin Griffiths, who has recently been in touch with you about the treatment doled out to him by the hierarchy at the Crown Office in Chester. He had an armed raid in May, and the faceless wonders at Crown Office have intimated he was culpable. Had him at the Kangaroo Court, where he was not allowed any representation of his own. He was a broken man then. However, he was sent for last Friday to attend a meeting with the Crown Office personnel again, and all weekend he's clearly not been himself. This morning he drove off to work, got out of his car, and walked in front of a bus. He's dangerously ill in hospital at Liverpool. The post office had driven him to suicide. All the family are at the hospital. I'm alone waiting by the phone for further news of him. I'd urge you to publicise this. Another incident that's been caused by the bully boys at Crown Office. May God forgive them. Mr. Bates continues. I'm aware of Martin's case. I know he was terrified to raise his shortages with the post office because of just this type of thing happening to him. But the post office got him in the end. Regardless of what may or may not have occurred with him, why did the post office have to hound him to the point of trying to take his own life? Why? Despite numerous warnings of never to attend any discussion with post office without legal representation, Martin, trying to be helpful, didn't take anyone with him as per the conditions the post office demand. If the post office cannot control their personnel, then the very least they can do is authorise and insist on a sub-postmaster taking legal representation with them in a meeting with post office. I'm very, very angry about this, and as per the wishes of the family, I'll be contacting many of the media contacts we've built up with over the years. This is an email chain between you and Susan Crichton that begins on that evening, the evening of the 23rd of September. Page one, please. Susan Crichton at 9:38 says, confirm I've spoken to Alan Bates, explained that the family had been in touch today and asked for help in branch as the sub-postmaster had been involved in a car accident. I explained Andrew's looking into this. We'll catch up with him tomorrow. Alan's rung back to say the message car accident was a miscommunication from a family member and it's definitely a suicide attempt. Andrew and I will agree how to handle this tomorrow. As the facts read the sub-postmaster are not as represented by the email. See your reply at 10:12 that night. Thank you. 2 points for me tonight. Firstly, but most importantly in the exchanges, I haven't seen anything re how Martin Griffiths is. Do we know how, do we know, are we in the loop? And then, if it's an attempted suicide, as we sadly know, there are usually several contributory factors. Are the police involved? And are we in direct contact with the family? At this stage, why were you raising the fact that there were usually several contributory factors involved?
The first thing to say is, as I say in my statement, I am very sorry about this, and that just sounds too shallow. Every email you will see from me about Mr. Griffiths, I start with him and how he was or how his family are. The post office took far too long to deal with it. And to answer your question about contributory factors, one of the other things that I had to do as chief executive was to understand, if there were details, to understand how this... I would have to communicate something so serious as this to the board. And I think I was trying to find out whether there was anything else behind it. I had a personal experience of a previous post office colleague who had took their own lives. And I phoned...
Oh, stop. There's no tears. Your eyes don't go red and you recover in seconds. We've seen this before and we'll see it again. No one's falling for it.
I phoned the family and I spoke to the father, who explained to me that there were other issues involved. And I imagine that, I'm sorry, I imagine that I was probably...
Miss Vennells, just rather than trying to talk through your...
Sorry, I beg your pardon.
Just pause.
Yes, okay.
Try and compose yourself if you can, and then continue your evidence, please.
Put your dry tissue down.
Thank you. In this particular case, I had spoken to the sub-postmaster's father, who had said to me that there were other contributory factors in his son's death, and they were very grateful for the call that I had made. In Mr. Griffith's case, I also offered to do the same, and I was told by the general manager of the Crown Offices that that wasn't needed and other people were in the loop. I imagine that what I was doing here in this email was recalling that previous incident. But what you'll see is that in every email that I wrote on this, my first concern was for Mr. Griffiths and his family. And as I said in my statement, I'm sorry is an inadequate word. I'm just so sorry that Mr. Griffiths isn't here today.
You say secondly, and very definitely in that order, Alan Bates' email is worrying. Especially as we hoped we had a working relationship. He clearly doesn't or doesn't want to trust us. Who's closest to him, do you think? It would be unfortunate if we lost him at this stage, but equally, we need to be straight about how unhelpful this kind of exchange is.
What I was trying to say there is that Alan was rightly very, very angry about this. His language about post office colleagues was extreme, as we've seen. I knew those post office colleagues, or at least some of them, and didn't believe they were capable of the behaviours that he was suggesting. And so as chief executive, secondly, and very differently in that, definitely in that order, I wanted to both understand about care for post office colleagues, but also the relationship with Alan, because we were in the process of trying to work with Alan and Second Sight on some of the issues. And so what I was trying to do here was to balance a number of things. But as I say, in every single case, the most important focus was on Mr. Griffiths and his family.
You say in your statement, no need to turn it up, that this was a time of great distress for Mr. Griffiths' family. And I felt that accusations of blame were unhelpful in explaining these lines here. Is that right? That you felt that Mr. Bates's accusations of blame were unhelpful?
I think at this stage, in something as tragic as this, accusations of blame were unhelpful, yes. Because the post office needed to respond to this properly. And at that stage, I had no understanding as to what had gone on.
Were you in that third paragraph there, there are usually several contributory factors trying to sow a seed that there may be factors other than those identified by Mr. Bates, i.e. the post office being to blame, that require to be investigated.
No, I don't think I was making that connection at all.
There's an email from Mr. Breeden to Angela Vanden Bogaard and Mr. Chester. We'll see later that you get copied in on this chain. You're not at the moment. This is the 11th of October now, at 7:31 in the evening. To confirm our conversation, Glenn, he was the local manager, had spoken to Mr. Griffiths' sister to offer condolences following the very sad news of Mr. Griffiths having passed away this afternoon. Glenn received notification of Mr. Griffiths' death by text message earlier this evening from his sister, Jane. The text was worded, "Sadly, my brother, Martin, passed away this afternoon after being in a coma for 18 days. The family is devastated at such a waste of life and feel the post office has ruined yet another life. Thought you should like to know as you liked my brother." And then if we scroll up, please, we see that that's passed on to you at 8:43. Sadly, Martin Griffiths has passed away this afternoon. Yes?
Yes.
And then scroll up, please. 9:28 that night, you say, "Thank you for sending over this news. I'm so sorry. Martin's family must be devastating. I know sadly from experience in business and personally that there's rarely a simple explanation for such death, even though it's often easier for those so closely affected to look for one. Three requests. Firstly, if I can help in any way that you're the team dealing with it, ask me. I'd be happy to speak or to or meet the family if we thought that would help." And I think that's what you were referring to a moment ago.
Yes.
"Secondly, that we look after them as much as we can and as they will allow. And thirdly, we look after Glenn. He'll be feeling very bad because he knew Martin and was the person closest to him from the post office." And scrolling down. "And then we need to look to the business. To help me brief this properly to the board, can you let me know what background we have on Martin and how, why this might have happened?" And then you say this, "I had heard, but have yet to see a formal report that there were previous mental health issues and potential family issues." Can you see that?
Yes.
"Were you asking your team here to dig into Mr. Griffiths' records? To look for information or evidence that he took his life because of mental health issues or family issues?"
So first of all, I'm so sorry, because I had, as chief executive, to pass this information on to group executive and to board colleagues. And what I would have expected were the questions that I think I was trying to anticipate here, that Mr. Bates had said that the post office was to blame. And I did know from previous examples and other information that it doesn't matter. I simply should not have said it. I shouldn't have used these words.
No.
You say, "I have heard," or "I had heard." From whom did you hear that there were previous mental health issues and potential family issues?
I don't recall. I believed I had also seen something in an email somewhere, but I don't recall.
Was it rumour at this stage if you hadn't seen a formal report?
No, I don't believe so.
Can you help us any more?
No, I can't. The only clear memory I have about this is that the people I was dealing with at the post office were very, very sad about this. And one of my roles as their boss was to try to help them through it as well. But I can't remember. Rumour would be a very inappropriate word.
Bearing that sentence in mind there, this is the next day, the Saturday, the 12th, and it's 9:01 in the morning, and you are emailing a group of people. You say, "I possibly heard but may be confusing with a previous case, that Martin had some mental health issues. How do you possibly hear something?
I think I'm simply stating an uncertainty.
You say you might be confusing it with a previous case. Why were you saying this at all, if you might be confusing Mr. Griffith's case with another case?
I'm trying to make sure, I believe, that there isn't confusion. I shared with you earlier that I spoke to the father of a previous colleague, and it may be that I was recalling that.
In your witness statement, there's no need to turn it up. You say, I was very aware of the background to suicide. It can be complex and is sometimes not apparent until long after the fact. And there's often a desire by those closely affected by such a death to look for an explanation. By telling us that, is your evidence that you were looking to explain Mr. Griffiths' death for the benefit of his family, and that's why you were asking these questions?
No. I was simply trying to get to understand whether what Mr. Bates has suggested, which is that the post office, i.e. colleagues in the post office, had been responsible for Mr. Griffith's death.
And his sister had said the same.
And his sister had said the same, yes.
You knew it was the family's view that Mr. Griffiths had taken his own life because it had been ruined by the post office, didn't you?
I did see that, yes.
You had just been told about his death, and you were trying to get on the front foot here, weren't you?
No. No, Mr. Beer, that was not the case.
You were trying to find out information. You were tasking the team with finding out information to counter any narrative that the post office was to blame, weren't you?
No, Mr. Beer, I've said that, and you've seen that I asked about the family, and as there are other emails which go through trying to find some payment for Mrs. Griffiths as well. What I was trying to do, quite simply, it was to get the wider picture and not to be, and to understand particularly the very difficult challenges that Mr. Bates had levelled at some post office colleagues.
Lastly, by way of general questions, I just want to ask you briefly about recollection and failures in recollection. Without turning them up, you say, at paragraph 358 of your witness statement in relation to correspondence with Simon Baker and Alwyn Lyons. I'm just picking some examples here. If the conversation was about the bugs, I don't know if I was told about them on that date or later. Paragraph 424, you say you cannot recall what steps were taken to ensure that Second Sight had been informed what the post office knew about the bug. Paragraph 773, you say, I do not recall the Simon Clark advices being discussed or provided to the board. And that there are examples where you say throughout your statements that you lack recollection in relation to facts that might be damaging to the post office. Yes? In your witness statement, however, would this be right? You have no problem remembering things that put responsibility or attribute blame to others. You say there was a further conversation that isn't noted. I remember that this reassured me that the issue had been resolved. I recall telling Susan this was a stupid thing for John Scott to have done. This was in relation to the statement that weekly meetings should be not recorded or that the minutes should be shredded. I asked Susan a number of questions about the removal of the Fujitsu expert witness. Why is it that you can remember things that are exculpatory of you, that tend to diminish your blameworthiness?
No, I don't believe that's the way I approach my statement at all, or any of the works of the inquiry. I've approached it with the intention of integrity and truth and honesty.
Why is it that in your witness statement, when you refer to a recollection of a conversation that's unminuted, undocumented, not referred to in any email, there are always things that exculpate you, that reduce your blameworthiness?
That isn't the approach I've taken.
Some might say that that has been an approach by others who have given evidence in the inquiry. They have great difficulty in remembering things unless it paints them in a favourable light. Was there an issue, a systemic issue in the post office, that people only looked to the good and forgot the bad?
No, I can't comment on other people, and I give you my word, as I've said earlier today, that I will respond in complete truth to this inquiry and have done in my statement. So my approach to this is, I hope, with integrity. Within the post office itself, I don't recollect that, and you've already mentioned that there was a positive culture in the organisation of lessons learned. I introduced something...
I don't think I've said that.
No, sorry, you didn't say positive culture. You mentioned lessons learned.
Yeah.
I'm explaining that was a culture in the post office, and there was a positive intention behind that, which was to learn lessons all of the time. I mentioned that I encourage bad news is good news, and you will see in inquiry documentation that the word pre-mortem is used very often. And that was an attempt to both, from lessons learned, to read into actions going forwards where things might go wrong. So there was an intention from my leadership, certainly, and I believe the people I worked with, to look for and learn from mistakes.
I think you worked for the post office for 12 years in total, is that right?
That's right.
You joined in January 2007?
Yes.
You were made managing director in October 2010?
Yes.
And you left as CEO in April 2019?
I did.
On a point of detail, whilst we're dealing with that chronology, when Alan Cook gave evidence last month, he suggested that you may have signed off on the post office spending some £300,000 in costs pursuing a £26,000 debt said to be owed by Lee Castleton. The main hearing in Mr. Castleton's case took place between the 6th and the 13th of January 2006, with the judgment being handed down on the 13th of January 2007. I think you joined the post office in the same month, January 2007.
I did, and so I couldn't possibly... I wasn't there to sign off that money. I hadn't joined the organisation. His recollection is incorrect.
So it follows, I think, that you were not responsible for signing off the very substantial legal spend in that case?
No.
Thank you. In terms of your previous career before joining the post office, is it right that noticeable features of it are that you had no experience of managing a large IT team?
That's correct.
And you had no experience of an organisation which investigated or prosecuted its staff?
That's correct.
You say in your witness statement on a number of occasions that you put to the fore the suffering of the sub-postmasters. And you say, by comparison, the post office's own reputation was of small import or importance compared to protecting the trust built up daily by colleagues working in post offices across the country.
That's correct.
That's paragraph.
The two were connected. Yes.
That's paragraph 47. And in your statement, you refer numerous times to the importance of protecting public money.
Yes.
Were you preoccupied with the notion of protecting public money?
Not preoccupied with it, no, but as part of the governance of working for a public sector organisation, there is a document called Managing Public Money. And when I joined the Royal Mail in 2007, I remember being surprised at how often that was spoken about. But of course it's because it was important, because all public organisations are funded through public money.
In your statement, you refer on numerous occasions to the importance of the post office's reputation and brand. Were you preoccupied with the need to protect the post office's reputation and brand?
Yes, but not to the extent of putting that over and above the suffering of the sub-postmasters. And
did you know they were suffering?
I understood. That's a difficult question to answer, because the answer is yes and no. I understood from, clearly, if people were being prosecuted, that was a very difficult thing. And the reason that we put in place the review with Second Sight and the complaint and mediation scheme was to look into that. I wasn't personally aware at the time, because I wasn't involved in the prosecutions. But I would like to say that, and I do say this in my statement, whenever I spoke about the post office brand, it was a brand that was only ever built up through post offices. And it was a very strong belief of mine, which I mentioned at conferences and meetings, that Post Office Limited, as a corporate entity, there was no reason to build that as a brand. The reason customers came to the post office and people chose to work for it was because of the wonderful work that was done in post offices across the country, and still is every day. And that was the brand I was talking about. In fact, when I became chief executive, people used to call the corporate entity they work for POL. And I said, no, we work for the post office. Post offices are why we are here. So brand was absolutely important, but in the sense of the local post offices.
You just said that you did not put brand and reputation above the postmaster's suffering. What suffering were they undergoing?
We have heard through the inquiry, I sat through the statements.
No,
I'm sorry.
You were telling us that at the time you did not put the post office's brand or reputation above the postmaster's suffering.
In terms of a personal approach, I don't ever recall that being a motivation. I can see with hindsight that there will be many examples of where that is clearly the case, because the post office got this very wrong.
You tell us in paragraph 49 of your witness statement that when you joined the post office, you had no understanding of the board's responsibility for the oversight of criminal investigations or prosecutions.
That's correct.
And nor did, in fact, you appreciate, you say, even that it brought its own prosecutions.
That's right.
Is that right?
Yes.
What was your understanding when you joined of the post office's geographical remit in respect of investigations and criminal cases involving sub-postmasters?
When I joined the post office, I was not aware that there were differences in terms of the different nations in the UK having different approaches to that. So my assumption would have been that the investigations and the prosecutions, which I now know were conducted, which were conducted through Royal Mail Group, would have been across the UK.
Well, when you became managing director in October 2010, did you know by then that the post office conducted its own criminal investigations and pursued its own prosecutions?
No, I say in my statement, I don't believe I became aware of that until 2012.
This is an RCC, a Risk and Compliance Committee meeting of the 28th of March 2008. So 4 or so years before the date that you've given us. And we can see that you're present, yes?
Yes, yes.
And you were, I think, a member of the Risk and Compliance Committee at this time?
I was.
As network director?
Yes, yeah.
John Scott presented the crime risk elements of the revised PAC, an overview of supply chain and network burglary and robbery incidences. A fraud update was detailed, which showed year-to-date fraud figures of 4.6 million captured within 292 raised cases. John advised the committee that a fraud strand restructure had seen greater focus placed on the identification and drive of proactive fraud initiatives, as opposed to simply delivering investigative casework. What would you have understood to have been traditional investigative casework?
I don't recall. I may well have asked in the meeting, but I don't recall.
Would that not tend to suggest that at this meeting there was a discussion about investigative casework conducted by the post office?
There could have been. Are there any minutes of the meeting?
That's what we're looking at.
Oh, that's at the minute. No, in which case I don't recall. I'm sorry.
Scroll down. John Scott then outlined the asset recovery position year to date. In summary, £1.6 million have been recovered against closed cases, and the two trainee financial investigators were performing solidly. The 2008-09 Crown Loss Initiative would see security team personnel target Crown Estate losses with a view to reducing by at least 25%. Isn't this indicative of a discussion about the post office investigating itself, its own fraud?
Yes, it looks as though it is. I'm not sure that I would have taken anything untoward from that. That would be a sensible thing to do across the size of the post office estate.
So by at least March 2008, you would have appreciated that post office conducted criminal investigations in its own name?
I don't know that I took that from this.
Who did you think was doing the investigating? Two trainee financial investigators, for example.
Yes, I can see that. I don't think I would have read anything more into... I can't recall the conversation, I'm very sorry, but two financial investigators would seem to be, or however many, a sensible resource for an organisation to have if it is managing money and it's looking into whether there are examples of fraud. But
isn't the whole context of this discussion that the post office is investigating? It has its own investigators.
It is, yes.
So you would have known by March 2008 at least that the post office investigated crime itself?
No, I don't believe I would have taken that from this at all.
And why not?
Because as I read it, it doesn't say that.
Who would the trainee investigators work for?
I imagine they work for John Scott, for head of security.
And he works for the post office?
At the time, he worked for Tony Marsh and Royal Mail Group, yes.
But they work for him and he works for the post office?
Yes, yes.
So they would be investigating fraud? Yes? Post office people would be investigating fraud?
Yes, that's how it reads.
And therefore you would have been aware, listening to this discussion, that the post office itself investigated criminal offences?
No, I didn't take that. I'm very sorry if I should have understood that from this conversation, but I didn't take that. My understanding would be... I did not know, and I certainly not at this stage, and the inquiries heard Alan Cook and David Smith as well, both predecessors didn't either. I didn't understand that the post office was bringing its... was bringing its own criminal investigations. I don't think I would have thought anything unusual of the fact, because investigation can be taken at all sorts of different levels. I certainly didn't read into this that post office was conducting criminal investigations to the level that I later understood, where these colleagues were then producing evidence to a particular standard in terms of, I think it was called the Police and Criminal Evidence Act or the Code of Crown Prosecutors. I didn't understand that. I didn't make that association at the time.
Mr. Scott is recorded as saying that the asset recovery position in the year to date was that £1.6 million had been recovered against closed cases. Doesn't that presume that the post office is doing the recovery?
Not necessarily. Excuse me.
Who did you think would be doing the recovering?
I don't recall the meeting from 2008. It's very difficult to, and I am not trying to be disingenuous in any way on this. I simply don't recall the meeting. I don't know whether more information was discussed in the meeting. I could speculate that I might have thought that it, if I didn't ask questions, that it was a combination of internal or external recovery. I'm very sorry, but I simply don't remember and don't know.
I wouldn't expect you to remember what's discussed at a meeting so long ago. But would you agree that this record of the meeting, from this record of the meeting, it's reasonable to infer that that position was that it was openly discussed that the post office was conducting investigations of its own staff and recovering money from them?
Yes, I think that's a reasonable inference to draw.
So why is it that you say that it was not until 2012 that you appreciated that?
Because the inference I may have drawn in that meeting is not the same as what I learnt in 2012, which is we were doing a very different level of investigation in terms of professional codes and criminal investigations. The only acceptable answer to the questions you're giving me on this is that I should have known and I should have asked more questions, and I and others who also didn't know should have dug much more deeply into this. When I joined Royal Mail in 2007, and this is a year later, it was an organisation in which postmen and women, sub-postmasters, were investigated and I now know, prosecuted by the organisation. It had been going on for many years. It was a historic reality and it became a continuing reality, and I simply joined that. And it was a serious mistake that I didn't understand before 2012 the extent of what this meant, and I didn't. And I'm really sorry.
You're telling us that for 5 years, as network director and then as MD, so between 2007 and 2012, you did not know that there was a department called POID, the Post Office Investigation Division, that it employed up to 100 people, and that their job was to conduct criminal investigations around the country into your staff?
I certainly didn't know the size of the team, that's for sure. I understood that there were investigators and that John Scott led a security team. But I did not understand the extent of what it was until 2012, and I'm very sorry for that.
When and in what circumstances did you become aware that the Post Office conducted its own criminal investigations?
I understood that postmen, postwomen and postmasters were prosecuted. My understanding was that that was done through external authorities. It was in 2012 when I believe that we started to look in much more detail, when the challenges were raised by Lord Arbuthnot and Sir Oliver Letwin. And I think it was in the time before that meeting with both those MPs that there was a board, either before or during a board discussion, I and others were made aware that this was the case.
When did you first become aware that the Post Office brought its own private prosecutions?
I believe in 2012, around
the same time.
Yes, yes.
And again in the same circumstances?
Yes.
Were you surprised? I've been working for this company for 5 years. I didn't know we, rather unusually, prosecute our own staff.
Yes, I think a number of us were surprised.
Was there no discussion of that in all of the years that you served on the Risk and Compliance Committee?
Not that I can recall.
Was there any discussion, so far as you can recall, before 2012 amongst the Post Office Board or the executive team concerning the discharge of the Post Office's prosecutorial function?
No.
And do you know how that is, that this little backwater of activity was going on.
My...
Without anyone at a senior level seemingly knowing about it.
That's the point I was trying to explain earlier, is that it's completely unacceptable that was the case, and that people did, including myself, that I didn't know. And my only explanation for that is that it had been going on for so long that it was an accepted reality. It was a status quo that I joined and accepted I shouldn't have done.
But isn't accepting the reality an acknowledgement of an awareness of the reality? Mr. Beer's pressing you on how it could possibly be that you weren't aware of the use of a function which was highly unusual for a private company. When I say private, you know what
yes,
I mean.
Yes, yes, I do.
Not the
yes.
CPS.
I agree, Sir Wynne. The way Mr. Beer describes it is that it was a function that one didn't hear about. We knew about cases being prosecuted, and I believe I can't remember that the Post Office Board met infrequently. Whether there were significant litigation reports that came to the Post Office Board before I became Chief Executive, I can't remember. Mm-hmm. But I think everybody's understanding, mine included, was that where prosecutions were conducted, they were conducted by external authorities.
Well, that's what I've been told repeatedly, but there was at least one case 2 years before 2012, Mrs. Misra's case, which attracted a great deal of publicity. I mean, it does seem extremely surprising that it didn't filter through at that point, that it was actually the Post Office who was prosecuting, not the CPS.
I agree. I haven't seen anything in the documentation that points to the fact that one would have known that.
I don't think I need documentation to infer that this might be a point of discussion among senior people.
I apologise. My point about documentation was whether there was anything that would have prompted my memory. I have no recollection of... Well, I have no recollection of Mrs. Misra's, of being involved in conversations about Mrs. Misra's case, which we may come on to. I do have two separate recollections on that. There were not, as far as I know, discussions about the fact that it was Post Office who had investigated and had brought to the prosecution. The assumption was that it was brought by external authorities.
Sorry, Mr. Beer, and I'll be quiet, but what about the discussions relating to separation? The Royal Mail and the Post Office were separating, but virtually all the lawyers were Royal Mail employees,
yes,
weren't they?
Right. Yes, they were.
So there had to surely be some discussion about what was going to happen when the prosecutorial function was going to be conducted not by Royal Mail employees, but by Post Office employees.
There was no discussion at board level about that. There was a huge programme of change. That the IT separation stream itself had over 200 different projects in it. So this was a massive, massive undertaking. And I know that Susan Crichton had asked Hugh Flemington to look into this, but I only know that from what I've read in disclosure. There was clearly discussion going on. The project itself was led by Mike Young, who was the chief operating officer at the time. But I don't believe there was any discussion about the fact that it was Post Office bringing prosecutions. For all of the separation projects, and some carried on into 2014 actually, but for all of the projects, we almost lifted and shifted because the timescale was so tight. So the investigation, the security team, the legal, the IT, etc., anything, HR, anything, company secretary, anything that was done within Royal Mail Group was moved almost unchanged into post office, and then in some cases was reviewed later where they could make changes if they did it. That took place. But my understanding on the legal side is that it was literally that the service was taken into post office in the same way that it ran in the Royal Mail Group.
Sorry, Mr. Beale.
Thank you. Did you know of the fearsome reputation of the post office investigation division amongst sub-postmasters?
Not at the time. When we got into the feedback from Second Sight and the complaint and mediation scheme, yes, there were complaints made by postmasters, and those were picked up straight away. Part of the branch support programme, but also Susan Crichton commissioned a piece of work which I don't know what happened to it, but looked into the investigation team. I, at the time, was sponsoring a culture change programme in the post office, and so when I heard about that feedback, I personally spoke to John Scott and was involved with him in a couple of workshops on the culture change. The response I got back, as the inquiry's heard, is that he was surprised at the feedback. But
and when you spoke to John Scott about this, did you say, John, I've been in the organisation 5 or 6 years now. I didn't know you had a team of 100 people that were investigating up and down the country sub-postmasters and sending them to prison. How come I didn't know?
I spoke to John Scott about this, I think, in 2014. His team was that size at the time, and I spoke to him very seriously about the culture and the behaviours and the fact that sub-postmasters and colleagues that worked in post offices were really important to us. John understood that.
I'm concentrating on how this thing was going on, that dozens of prosecutions occurred when you were network director. Dozens of prosecutions occurred when you were managing director. Collectively, hundreds of prosecutions went on, conducted by the post office, having been investigated by the post office, and you didn't know about it until 2012. So when you spoke to John Scott, did you not say, how's this all been going on? Who's managing you? Why doesn't the board know about this?
At the time I spoke to John Scott, all that had changed. We had stopped prosecutions, his team had been substantially reduced in number, and we were looking into the complaints made by the sub-postmasters.
So, thank you. Can we take our second break?